Well, it will likely come as no surprise at all, particularly given that I just turned the story from the Gospel of John about the first time Jesus meets the disciples into a knock-knock joke, that I am often considered to be quite irreverent. My only defense is I think Jesus was probably quite irreverent also. I think Jesus really did have a sense of humor. I think Jesus really did like engaging people where they were at. And you know where the people he was meeting were at? They needed some joy. And so I think it's important to find that joy. I also think that it's important to find that joy as part of our journey in belief, in faith. As much as I might be a little bit irreverent sometimes, a lot irreverent sometimes, I could not possibly come close to the guys from South Park who wrote the musical The Book of Mormon. Now, I've mentioned the musical The Book of Mormon before, because, and I'm going to mention it again, because in part every time we get to this second Sunday of Easter and we tell this story, it reminds me of the Book of Mormon. If you've seen it, you're probably wondering how that could possibly be. And if you're somebody who hasn't seen it, I'll just say it's a very humorous and satirical look at how we do mission. It's also kind of rude and obscene. But what it says that's true about how religion does mission is true of everyone who does mission. Every institutional religion that does mission work. What's at the heart of this story that is irreverent and humorous and rude, obscene? Okay, it's all that stuff, sure. But what's at the heart of it is something that's true about how we have tended as institutionalized religion to do mission work. And first of all, I think they could have targeted anybody. I truly do. Sure, the Mormon Church has some quirky stuff that you can mine for some good jokes, but I think it's true to say that the message that's in this story is true of any institutional religion. I'd also like to say, by the way, that if you're going to, let's say, skewer the mission work of institutionalized religion, the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints is a good pick, because, well, let me put it this way. When Dan Brown wrote The Da Vinci Code, in which he suggested in a fictionalized way that Jesus had children and his descendants are alive today, the Vatican lost it. They in fact, they said, don't read that book. It's sacrilege. Don't read that book, which, of course, guaranteed people were going to read the book. When Book of Mormon opened on Broadway, the Mormon Church bought ads in their program. They bought ads that said, if you like this show and you think this is funny, come and see what we're really like. They didn't feel threatened. They felt pretty secure, I think, in who they are and how they are. And the thing that brings me to that every second Sunday of Easter is this idea about doubt, and as if Thomas was the only one who did. And the thing that brings me there is a song in Book of Mormon called I Believe. And it's a point at which Elder Price is really beginning to doubt. He's beginning to question what he's doing and why he's doing it. And he sings a song, I Believe, in which, over a series of refrains, usually in groups of three, which, by the way, is really Trinitarian if you think about it, he says things that, as a Mormon, he believes. So, and they're usually in groups of three. The first two are pretty straightforward things that we can get a handle on. And the third is usually something that's, let's just say, uniquely Mormon and a little quirky. But then it gets to this point where he says, I am a Mormon, and a Mormon just believes. I don't think that's true. I don't think Mormons just believe any more than anybody else just believes. And I think that's a challenge for us. Because we want to say, we want to read this story about Thomas, we want to go, don't doubt, believe. As if flick a switch and just believe. And that's not how it works for anybody. In fact, by the way, just while I'm thinking about it, if you look through YouTube, you'll find there's a series of videos that the Mormon Church produced in which they have individuals talk about how they have questioned their faith and how they have come around to understanding it better because they questioned their faith. And of course, it's produced by the church, so they always come round again, and lots don't. But the point of that is, you don't just flick a switch and believe. You don't. And as I was thinking about that, I was thinking, maybe that's part of understanding that somehow that is a possibility, maybe part of our misunderstanding of what doubt and faith are all about. Because doubt is part of the journey to faith. See, here's the thing. Let me just recap the story for you. Despite the fact that the women were the only ones who hung around, they were the only ones who were at the crucifixion. Okay, sure. We got the stories about Peter denies Jesus. We got the story about the disciple whom Jesus loved, which, by the way, is also in John only. Being at the crucifixion, but really it was the women who stayed. The disciples ran. They left. We don't hear from them again until, oddly enough, after the resurrection. But the women stayed. The women followed Jesus. They saw him die. They saw his body laid in the tomb. And then they had to wait because they wanted to anoint the body for burial. But it was too late in the day. It was now the Sabbath. Sabbath begins at sundown. It was too late. They had to wait. Even the women who saw him die, saw him put in the tomb, and who returned on Sunday morning to anoint the body for burial, were not expecting to find him alive. Even with the angel apparently saying to them, just as he said he would, by the way, let's just remind you all, he said this would happen. They're still surprised. It's not a, I knew it moment. It's a, what happened? They don't believe he's physically alive. And Mary, depending on which story you read, Mary, of course, runs into him thinking it's the gardener. And doesn't recognize him. The women see him, and he tells them to go and tell the disciples. They go and tell the disciples. The disciples, surprise, don't believe them. And even when they go and look for themselves, it's not until Jesus appears to them. And when Jesus appears to them, what is the first thing he does? Look at the wounds. It's like he felt he had to prove to them it was him. Because he just kind of appeared, and maybe they didn't recognize him. He had to prove it. So don't be telling me Thomas is the only one who doubts. They all do. All of the stories are about Jesus not being recognized. People weren't expecting him to be physically alive. They just weren't. Thomas's doubt wasn't in Jesus. Thomas's doubt was in the other disciples and their story. Let me just say more about that. Because I've always believed that the reason Thomas wasn't there in the story is that Thomas was out telling people about Jesus. He may not have believed that Jesus was physically there, but Jesus was sure still alive. For Thomas. And Thomas was out keeping Jesus alive for others. So before you jump to that bit about Thomas doubting because he wasn't there, go back to the beginning of that little vignette for a second. Okay, let's skip past the knock-knock joke, but get to the part where Jesus says, as the Father sent me, so I send you. Receive the Holy Spirit. Go out into the world and share this with everyone. Because that's how Jesus is alive. The physical manifestation part, no one recognized him. Let me say that a little differently. In the other stories, they recognize him in him doing something, like breaking bread with them. That's how he's revealed to them. They recognize an action. Isn't that how Jesus is alive for all of us? We don't need to see the physical Jesus. We need to see the real Jesus that's alive in all of us. The point of Jesus, I think, is the stories of Jesus of Nazareth, the pre-resurrection stories of Jesus of Nazareth, the stories about caring for people, about compassion, about understanding, about engaging people, about bringing love to the world. That's even the most crucial thing to John, right? Love one another as I have loved you. That's how people will know you are disciples of mine. He might as well have said, that's how people will know I am alive in you. Go and do it. We so often read this story as if Thomas was the only one who doubted, and the only one who doubted because he didn't see the physical Jesus. None of them saw the physical Jesus until, in the stories, until he shows them it's him. My question would then be, wouldn't he still have been alive to them as they thought about all of the time they'd spent with him, all of the things they'd learned and experienced with him? Wasn't he already still alive? That's why I think Thomas was out telling people about Jesus. He was still alive. Even for the women who saw him die and saw him placed in the tomb, even coming to the tomb, expecting to anoint a dead body, Jesus was still alive to them. That's why doubt is part of the journey of faith. It's not the thing that keeps you from it. It's part of the journey. It's the thing that reminds you to ask questions and wonder. It's the thing that reminds you not to just go with what you see or go with what somebody told you. It reminds you to think about it. And not just with your head, but with your heart, with your spirit, to engage it. That's faith. Faith isn't just for thinking people. It's for people who think with their hearts as well as their minds. It's for people who ask the questions. That's part of the journey of faith. That's what this story says to me. That's what this story says to me. And that's also what, you know what? The thing that happens, spoiler alert. Of course, what happens in the Book of Mormon is that they decide to stay, right, and help the people. Because that's the quirk. Quite often our mission in the past has been to go and save people for Jesus and then leave them. Not stay and give them the help that they truly need, the support, the ongoing love that they need. That's what's happening in this story too. It's not about whether or not they simply go, I believe. It's about how they take the Spirit, that has been given to them and go and share it with the world. That's how Jesus is alive in you and me. That's how Jesus is alive in the world. It's because alive in us, we share our life with the world. Jesus is alive. There's no doubt that Jesus is alive. The question is how and where and when will Jesus be alive for you?